This is Innovledia.
Hello and welcome back. In this video, I am going to show you how to use the render settings in Maya. Alright? Now, before you render the final output, you need to change some of the render settings in order to get the desired result. The render settings can be accessed in two ways. One is by going to the Windows menu, then Rendering Editors and clicking on Render Settings. Another is by clicking on this icon present on the status line. Let me place it here. Now, there are many tabs here and also sections, each having its own group of settings related to a specific purpose. The most commonly used settings are present under the Common tab and all the quality settings under the Arnold Renderer tab. Alright? Under the Common tab, we have all the general settings using which we can change the format and dimensions of the output. You just have to click on this drop-down and select the format for your output, whether you want the output to be in JPEG format or in PNG or in TIFF and so on. I mostly use the PNG format because it is a lossless format and supports transparent backgrounds. While JPEG format doesn't support transparent backgrounds, but it will definitely give you an output with a smaller file size when compared to other file formats. Okay? Then we have this another drop-down where you can select the naming system for your frames containing your animation. Especially if you want to export an image sequence as the output for your animation. Okay? If you are a little confused about what an image sequence really is, you can take a look at a practical example here. You see, these are called a sequence of images. It is like rendering every frame of your animation as an individual image. Later, we can easily create a video using this sequence of images. Alright? So, coming back to the settings, you can select from any of these predefined systems for naming your files. And you can always take a look at the preview of how everything is going to be right here within this window. The hashtag is replaced by the frame number as you render the animation. And the .ext stands for the file extension that is defined by the file format that you choose from here for the output. Choosing PNG format will give the images a .png extension, actually defining its format. Okay? You can change this frame padding to keep the numbering system to 4 digits or 3 digits or anything you wish. You can also set the range of frames that you want in the final output. This is the frame number from where it will start rendering until this frame where it will end the rendering process. But in case if you want to render only a single frame of your animation or just the scene, you can select this option which is single frame. Alright? Below that, we have a drop-down for selecting the renderable camera, which is like from which camera do you want to render the scene or animation, especially if you have created multiple cameras within your scene. You can even remove a camera from this section by clicking on this dustbin icon if you don't want to render using that camera. Later, you can add it again using this drop-down if you want to render your animation using that camera. And at last, we have this drop-down for selecting the dimensions of the output. You can select from here what kind of output you are seeking, such as high definition, which is this HD 720, or full HD, which is HD 1080, and so on. Alright? Once everything has been set here, we can move on to the Arnold Renderer tab. We are going to find here all the settings that are specific to Arnold Renderer. There are mainly two sections here that you are going to find useful most of the time. The first is the sampling settings, and the second is the ray depth settings located here. Okay, so coming to the sampling settings, we have here all the settings that are responsible for controlling the quality of the rendered output. The camera samples is like a global control for the quality of the entire output. It is used as a multiplier for all the other samples given here. And hence, as you increase this, you will see here on top that the diffuse, specular, and all the other samples increase as well, and that too exponentially. Of course, there is a mathematical formula working behind all of these settings and how they are connected together. But right now, let us keep this to simple, that every sampling setting here is responsible for controlling the quality of each of the aspect as their name suggests. Like, the diffuse samples controls the quality of the shadows formed on the surfaces of objects. No matter how light or dark the shadow is, there will always be some amount of noise in those areas. By increasing this number, you simply tell the renderer to do more calculations in those areas, which ultimately reduces the noise but increases the render time. So, if you want quality, you have to sacrifice time. And if you want to render the output in time, then you have to sacrifice its quality. Or otherwise, you can simply choose a better workstation for rendering. More processing power means quick rendering, okay? Similarly, the specular samples controls the noise within the highlights and reflections on a surface. The transmission samples controls the noise within the transparent surfaces, and so on. Always remember that these noises mostly appear within the areas where the shadows are soft or the reflections are blurry or the transparency is soft, like that of a diffused glass. Mostly in those areas, you are going to find noise, and so are the settings to control their amount. The more you increase them, the less will be the noise, and hence it will take more time and processing power to render the output. And also, do not always increase just the camera samples alone, thinking that increasing this will anyway increase the other samples as well. If you do that, you will end up with a very long render time for your project. So, instead of increasing just the camera samples, increase the sampling for only a particular aspect where you find the problem, like noise. And keep the camera samples to a standard value. Not too high, not too low. Alright? Now below this, we have the ray depth settings. It defines how many number of times light rays will bounce or reflect between surfaces or transmit through the surfaces before reaching the camera. The diffuse attribute will control the number of times light rays will bounce between the surfaces of objects. More bounces means more illumination within the scene. The specular attribute will control the number of times a reflective surface will be reflected on another reflective surface. In real, reflections can go up to any number of times, unless they diminish into a point. But here, you can put a limitation to that. I have a very good example of this. This is from one of my very old projects, rendered in Maya 2013. You can see that here, one mirror is reflected into another. It is like looking at a mirror that is in front of another mirror. Well, this reflection within reflection had to go up to many number of times, unless it diminished into a point, or line in this case. For this to happen, I had to increase the specular depth to almost around 80 or something, meaning that it will keep reflecting for at least 80 times after which it will stop reflecting and that portion will appear as a black area. Back then, we had a separate attribute for this effect, which was the reflection depth. But now everything has been included within this specular depth. Alright? There is one simple thing that you have to remember, that if the objects are closer to the camera and these reflections are noticeable, then you have to increase this ray depth. Okay? Now, coming to the transmission attribute, it controls the number of transparent surfaces through which light rays can pass before reaching the camera. On the other hand, the transparency depth controls the number of surfaces that are allowed to behave as transparent, which will not cast shadows like an opaque surface. In 3D, if an object has some depth or thickness, it is definitely going to have at least two surfaces that make up the depth. Every such surface will be counted as one while setting the transmission and transparency depth. If there are two surfaces, we can set this to either 2 or more than 2 if there are more surfaces through which light rays have to pass. If there is an insufficient transmission or transparency depth, the surfaces might start appearing black due to light not able to pass through them. So, increasing these numbers can help in fixing such problems. Both of these attributes work together when dealing with transparent objects, alright? In the same way, the volume attribute will control the number of times light rays will scatter within a volume, such as cloud and smoke. Increasing this will cause more scattering of light, which means more illumination within the volume. As we are not dealing with volumetrics, so we can keep this to 0 for now. And lastly, all of these values when added together gives a total number that is limited by this total attribute. If it is set to 10, then all of these together cannot go beyond this limit of 10 recursions. So, in order to allow more of these recursions to happen, you have to increase this number according to what you set for these attributes. But keep this in mind, that as you increase all these numbers, it will increase the rendered time as well. Hence, set these numbers to only what is sufficient for your scene. Neither too high nor too low. Okay? So these were all the necessary settings that you have to go through whenever you are going to render your scene or animation. Alright? See you in the next video.